Okay, ladies and gentlemen, introducing to you the outgoing director of the Museum of Natural History, Dr. Juan Carlos Gonzalez.
Thank you very much, Paul. So good afternoon, everyone. Again, thank you for Vice Chancellor Mardilinde, Ma'am Din. Thank you for the opportunity. I'd like to also thank the search committee for the opportunity to present results of our end term report for the Museum of Natural History. Of course, this is not my report, it's a report of the museum. It just so happens that I'm the director for those two terms. But also I would like to acknowledge the presence in our attendees of our faculty regent, Dr. Emilin Dupo, also our curator. Of course, from the search committee, ang past director, Professor Emeritus Edwino Fernando. And also in the attendees are yung sinundan ko po na director, si Dr. Ineo Lett Jr. Sir June, hello po, good afternoon. And of course, Dr. Lourdes Cardenas, also our previous director. So, and of course, I can see everyone from curators and staff, magandang hapon po. So hopefully I'll do justice to our 6 years. I think everybody can see that clearly. I hope it's okay. Good afternoon. This is the end of term report for the Museum of Natural History as the director. I started into February 2015, and of course, my post will end at this February 16, 2021. So hopefully, there are nominees, so we'll have a chance to do the search. And of course, we could pass on the baton to the next director. As you know, the Museum of Natural History is now on one of the units that is managed by the Office of the Vice Chancellor for Research and Extension. So we are, I think, one of the larger clusters or one larger units within ODICRE. And I'll try to give you sort of an overview of what happened in the past two terms as director. So it's a highlights of activities and accomplishments by the Museum of Natural History, which was implemented between 2015 and 2020. It's also an overview of the status of the facilities and of course our staffing programs of the museum. A summary of visitors and services and income that we generated so far. And of course, in the benefit of the next director, I put in some notable issues and challenges which suggest priorities that for consideration. Apart from all the data we put into the report, a lot of the data was derived from our yearly reports. We have annual reports submitted to OVCRE. Of course, this was prepared by our extensionist, Florante Cruz. Thank you, Flor. Of course, for further details, you may refer to the annual reports. And there are, of course, a lot of online sources from our webpage, mnh.uplb.edu.ph, the Wikipedia page, and all our social media accounts. So here, of course, showing you just the stark contrast of what we have before in 2015 and now in 2020, from the multitude of visitors to the museum. And of course, now, with our social distancing. Of course, the museum is closed for the moment. It is open to, the office is open for services and of course for researchers. But again, the exhibits are closed. So there's again, been a director for two terms. I'm very thankful for the opportunity because of the support of the previous directors and of course the curators, especially to Sir June, who I of course followed. He encouraged me to take the post. Now I'm being the 11th director. I'm also the first Zoo Wildlife to be director of the museum. And of course, I'm happy to continue the programs that started. And of course, a lot of exhibits that soon followed, that was already started and of course helped finish. Of course, my term was under Chancellor Fernando C. Sanchez. Of course, at the moment I became director, he actually asked me to look into the plan of expanding the museum, because there was originally a plan to have a new building for the museum. And of course, I went to talk to Vice Chancellor Magdang Bayan about it with OBCPD, looking into the modernization of a proposal to renovate and modernize the existing Museum of Natural History. Apart from that, that particular term, we had our 40th anniversary that all star-studded. We had a lot of conferences that were first implemented through the museum, such as a partnership with CIASA, and of course, our own Clades Museum Summit. I think that particular 3 years, I was gamit na gamit na po yung passport ko because I was able to travel a lot through a lot of these linkages in the museum from the Biolus Project in Germany, a lot of visitors from different universities, including Texas A&M. I was able to present at the Horndale Conference, and of course, was able to be involved in the ICOM, Natural History Group. ICOM is the International Council of Museums, which is a big world association of museums. Of course, there were a few things that happened that, of course, were a setback, such as the announcement of field trip restrictions, which, of course, lessened the number of visitors to the museum. Of course, we lost Ate Anna at the time. So again, it's this is just sort of the highlights for that particular term. And again, if you need further details, you do have a 3-year report on that. And of course, be at the end of term, I was able to revisit my own vision and mission. As you see, I was able to travel to Carnegie Museum to attend the ICOM. On my second term, the 2018-2020, it was sort of a different system in terms of the search committee, but again, it pushed through. We were able to go through the process. And again, thank you for the opportunity and also thankful for everyone involved. It actually marks one thing, because we have a letterhead at the museum that says, celebrate the decade of biodiversity, says 2010 to 2020. So we now actually have gone through that decade of biodiversity. And we're very happy that the museum was had a lot of accomplishments during that decade. Of course, it was the opportunity that President Danilo Concepcion and Mam Gabby was able to visit the museum and physically to see the museum and see the exhibits. We also had the opportunity to change our proposal into renovation, but also add in a few new programs in it. We were fortunate to have several external funded projects, able to travel to Chicago to attend the SPNHAC, which is the Society for the Preservation of Natural History Collections, visit the museum in Kansas, and of course, participate in the National Museum Summit in here in the Philippines. We also celebrated our 44th anniversary, even though it is during a pandemic. So everything was different because you had to do it virtually and online. Just before the pandemic, we were able to host the ANRRC conference, and I had a chance to visit Sichuan Botanic Gardens in China. Of course, again, always is sort of a sad part to it. So we had very little income coming in because of the COVID-19 pandemic. It's also the term where we lost James Alvarez. Very sad time for the museum. Again, if you the details of that particular term is included here in the end of term report, we have those annual reports to represent that. Of course, now with that we have a change in the UPLB admin. Again, before we were under Sir Rex Dimafidis, and now we welcome, of course, Dr. Litt as our vice chancellor for auditory. Thank you, Mamlet, for the opportunity. And hopefully for the next director. So here's an overview of the staff of the Museum of Natural History. Again, we are quite large in terms of regular staff as a unit under OBIGRE. There are 8 reps and 11 admin staff, which makes 19. I'm the 20th, so we're magic 20. During the 6 years, we were able to add in 2 items. Of course, one was sort of an upgrade for Kuya Boy. And then we had the additional lab technician, which is of course now taken by Des. We also have a CBO added because of the training that Dr. De Leon was able to get, which is very timely, especially with this pandemic, being a certified by safety officer. alongside the museum, even though we're a mixture of reps and admin staff, there are museum technicians that represent taxidermists, and of course, the people who do the collections management. Of course, there are also artists which help develop the exhibits. And all of them are invaluable in terms of running the museum. And of course, several of them are recognized as outstanding UPLB awardees. And for some of them published and have also international publication awards. One thing that we realized during those 6 years is hindi kami nakukumpleto. So it's not never a complete 18. There's always staff turnover, may dadating, may aalis. Especially with sort of a generation gap between the staff, so may kind of a series of people slowly retire. So nag-retire na po si Paeng Chandang, this year si Atilita Borromeo, and of course, susunod na po si Manny, and then si Dave. So yeah, it's sort of a series of people retiring and then new blood coming into the museum. So hopefully the two positions that were left will be filled in later. I'll discuss a bit further on that. For our curators, we're very fortunate to have a lot of people supporting us. These are seasoned taxonomists, mostly faculty who are seconded staff. So of course, we've retained the active list that we got from Sir June. So we followed that, of course, added in on that for certain taxa that needs to be covered. So all in all, there's like 38 faculty in and out that got appointed across 6 years. Although the average is about 30 to 33 per year in terms of appointed curators, because they are seconded staff and also they are doing this for free on their free time and no honorarium, no additional compensation. We did have some problems with appointment delays. So yeah, we're slowly working out how to fix that kasi nga, kailangan basic papers yung nagamitin for it. Of course, the selection is taxon-based and there are usually about three per collection. Or for a section. And of course, all colleges which have natural science or natural history involved in them is represented. So College of Agriculture and Food Sciences, College of Art and Sciences, College of Forest and Natural Resources, and of course, College of Veterinary Medicine, and CESA. Of course, we also have our bit of three or four professor emeritus included for that, including Sir Fernando. So to know the list of our curators as well as our staff, if you want to know them further, please go to our website and also the Wikipedia page to get further details. We actually have photos and of course details for each of our curators on our website. Also a chance you to visit the portal. The collections has grown immensely. We had about 614,022 specimens. Actually, that was a October list. Of course, I mean, there was a donation about 4,000 specimens recently. So that will then go up again. Numbers, that represents sort of a very significant number because being a university museum, it's quite large. And that I think represents, we can say we are the second largest natural history collection in the Philippines. Of course, there are certain taxa, which may be more than the others, but of course, the national collection always is at the National Museum. So we represent about eight different sections, which represents herbaria and zoological collections. So there's the Botanical Herbarium, which of course is also known as the College of Agriculture Herbarium, University of Philippines, or CAHUP. There's the Forestry Herbarium Wood Collection, or LBC. We also have the Mycological Herbarium, which hosts our fungi, Microbial Culture Collection, which hosts microbes from bacteria to microfungi. And then we have the Entomological Collection, which I think is the largest in the country. The Zoological and Wildlife Collection, which includes both malacological and the vertebrates, which also includes the D.S. Robor Wildlife Collection. We also have geological collections in the exhibits, as well as live collections of specimens, as well as live animals in our exhibits and as well in the auditorium. During that time, the two terms, there were 96 species that were described by curators and staff. Of course, again, the details are in our annual reports. About 50,000 were collected and roughly 13,000 were cataloged from that. So it's still a long way to go to complete the cataloging and identification of these specimens. But again, they're quite important as reference collections. So over the two terms, there were about 1,792 researchers who accessed the collection for their studies. And to make that more accessible, especially in this pandemic, we are undergoing a digitization project, which helps part of the database made available online, so you can access what specimens are available in the museum. And, back to that. And also, I was very fortunate and very thankful for our curators and staff. During my term, I was given the honor of being named three species. Mamdupo, of course, named a moth, a beautiful moth after me. Mam Hatzal, Ariel, and Michelle named a, and Mam Ivy named a jade vine after me. And Sir Lit and Christian named a cockroach after me, which is a small cave blind cockroach, which I think is the cutest cockroach of all. Thank you very much. Of course, being a university museum, we also support instruction. Also help in education, IEC. So there is, it is a teaching and reference collection. So we wanted to keep that. It's being used for teaching purposes as well as a reference collection. Of course, you have to put in some degree of what can be used and what cannot, because some of the specimens are heritage collections, which of course need to be protected. The museum was able to conduct 120 seminars, of which nearly 4,000 attendees. Again, this is at the time, which is not Zoom. Still, we have to attend physically at the seminar and given our small size conference room, but also we had the chance to use the obviously annex for that, for certain seminars that need more space. We also had short courses and trainings, of which 847 were trained, and had 72 interns and students who did their SPs at the museum. More importantly, there's 36 students who were able to complete or at least do part of their thesis at the museum during those two terms. We also help support certain classes, particularly in IBS for cave ecology. And we also have the Museum Herbarium Curatorship. There's a new wildlife curatorship that's being implemented. So yes, we'll be helpful to help conduct those classes. Although it's a little difficult for this time because of the pandemic, because most of the labs are not yet face-to-face. Several other classes, including classes from engineering, make use of the hortorium because they do their sampling at Malawing Creek, as well as do some biology classes. Overall, several students from preschool to university level do visit the museum and make use of the exhibits to understand natural history better. There's about more than 200,000 visitors, as well as guided tourists, were able to attend at these exhibits in the museums. It's quite amazingly high for a university museum, but small, and also we're quite off the way from Manila. Of course, being under OBICRE, we apart from extension, we have our research programs. There's a number of funded both funded and core funded projects that happen in the museum. About 201 together altogether help produce 128 articles in journals. So here's a list of them from the ones when I arrived. There was already the Popolisa study by Sir June. Some of the stuff study from projects in Matisarog, Mabini Caves, and of course the forests of Mulanay. Recently we had the expedition in Kalbaryo Patapat and some of the Teresita in Cagayan and Bugay wetlands. We had the EIDRDOST project together with several units in UPLB, which is the Forest Canopy Project. We have Project 3 on terrestrial fauna. It was a study that we continued that was proposed by James on in Podilio on echolocation. Of course, where it's an ongoing project from NRCT on bat guano, and we have a collaboration with Central Mindanao University on Mindanao Mountains under PICARDOST. We're also fortunate to have a BIFA-funded project on digitization mobilization of the collection, as well as an inventory of the board collection that was done previously. And most importantly, we were fortunate to have the BOSD-funded NICER Center for Cave Ecosystems Research, which will start this year. So within extension programs of the museum, we do have our short courses, especially on biodiversity surveys, of different trainings, both in-house and, of course, some which are attended by students and practitioners outside. So a total of 847 people have been trained through those short courses, most of which are done during the summer, which has now become our mid-year. Seminars, which we call the Biodiversity Seminar Series, now converted to Zoom, total of 120 seminars conducted across 6 years with about 3,790 participants. Publications, total 128 articles, 37 of which garnered international publication awards. And now we're revised the journal, the science journal of the museum, and called it Lasang Buhay. Already the first volume 7 is out, and now working on another issue. For technical assistance, we did have collaboration with the pest management group and BMB to two trainings on identification of pests and identification of threatened wildlife, flora and fauna. Alongside that, we did a lot of cooperative work doing biodiverse inventories for several other projects, from El Nido Park up to Santa Teresita to at the East KPNP, Siargao Project, NRCP, Mulanay, Mabini, Southwoods, Balisin, Mindoro with MBCFI. We sort of helped support projects such as BAMS and JRNP in some ways connected. We also had internship, both mostly from UPLB, because again, there was kind of a restriction in terms of internships, most of which are also from UPRHS, Rural High, and of course, Philippine Science High School. 72 total. Museum also recognized for its public service, especially with its multimedia access, being resource persons or technical people to be interviewed for certain news items that are gone viral. So some of them, for particularly Born to be Wild, Kapuso Mo, Jessica Soho, Ang Pinaka, Balitang K, and there's Atom Arroyo Specials, and of course Ding Dong's Amazing Earth, Sumika si Sir Junyata ang interview dyan. Of course, we also have Radyo Henyo at DZRH, as well as Matanglawin, and for some periodicals such as UPLB Horizon, Agritourist, and it's from DOST. In terms of our services, of course, we have our scientific name verification service, which is of course done free for, especially for our graduate students who are required to have this verification certificate if they have a scientific name on their title. So just on the title page. Of course, other colleges have now adopted to use this verification. A total of 702 services were done for this about 6 years. In some ways, we, being a museum, if it is an animal, people will come over and say, oh, we found this animal, it's this owl or this snake, or there's a snake in our house. So often, tumatawag sila sa museum to address these wildlife conflicts and or rescue in particular. So we do have, and sometimes, house them at the museum or then bring them off to DNR. Or if possible, release them back into the wild. And of course, our involvement with cave studies and of course now with biosafety committees. So very much involved on regional and national committees. For that, including most of the curators and staff have been involved in the red list, both the flora and fauna red list for DNR, PRLC, and then the aquatic red list for before. We've also been involved with NAS, especially through the Philippine Science Heritage Center. And apart from all the local channels, we also had Discovery Channel come over, Nat Geo Photo Art was here with Joel Sartore, and of course Nigel Hicks, who's a famous travel photographer, of course, went to the museum and helped. I'm around Mount Makiling. So we're also very fortunate to have helped in collaboration to implement certain conferences and exposure, both international and national. We had the first ever Clades Museum Summit, which aims to put together all the different natural history collections around the museum, around the Philippines, so alongside, especially with the National Museum. And it was a very interesting and very productive conference. So hopefully we'll have another chance to do it again. We'd also collaborated with the Southeast Asian Zoo Association and helped host the SIAZA conference here in Los Baños, as well as the ASEA Network for Resource Centers, and of course, Crocodilus Porosus Philippines to do the Croc Forum Symposium. Apart from that, we had a mini symposium within the ATBC meeting in Malaysia, the Association of Tropical Biologists in Biology Conservation. So we did a forest canopy symposium, which basically were just mostly the members of the forest canopy program, plus one other presenter. So it's quite interesting. We had a online symposia, mostly about zoonosis during our 44th anniversary, again, in line with the COVID-19 pandemic. We've also been presented in the Museum Summit, which is hosted by NCOM, and also certain three sets of ICOM, ICOM Natis and ICOM UMAC. And of course, we have our also collaboration with Museo Cordillera of UP Baguio. Apart from that, we, of course, had seminars. This was with UPOU, NAST, NRCP, PSM, and EDC, as well as all the other conferences held by AFAMS, BCSP, ASBP, and of course, Ateneo de Manila. So altogether, just 142 papers presented across those two terms, including 120 talks and seminars. So very busy across the, especially now with all the Zoom webinars. So again, there are about 200,000 visitors that went through our exhibit, mostly through organized tours of the different schools and of course several walk-ins, family groups. Again, it's saddening that we can't open. A lot of people are asking, but of course, because of the pandemic, have to remain closed until, of course, it is easier to contain and do the safe by safety protocols. Again, we are on planning how to safely reopen the museum once it's allowed. We also had a lot of special visitors coming in from, of course, the different UP officials, from, of course, President UP President Concepcion to the different vice presidents and, of course, all the different officials, as well as various ministers and ambassadors. I can remember Ambassador of Australia, Ambassador of South Africa, and a lot of ministers from the Pacific Islands. Of course, we had Dr. Curio here to do several talks. Nigel Marvin, as you know, who did Wild Philippines, and of course, Nat Geo's photo art tool, Sartori. We'd able to do the changes in terms of our rates, entrance fees with the museum, because that hasn't changed for several years. And of course, thank you for OBCA for helping us change that and approve that. And of course, came out with a memo under Chancellor Camacho. Thank you, Paul. The income for visitors from all from the entrance fees from across these six years totaled about 4,393,055 pesos. This is quite an interesting amount for a set of entrance fees that are 20 pesos and 10 pesos. So imagine we had the 100 pesos. But again, it is for service to the Philippines. Overall, together with all the other services that we have, with about 6 million across six years, or roughly about 1 million per year. So it was good, except for the later part of this 2020 where we had to close because of the pandemic. We tried to get an additional funding through projects, or either GI or GAA, Did have a few expenditure issues, but now we're learning through it. Again, the field trip issue, which reduced the number of tours and then increased the pandemic, had an effect on our the usual amount of visitors and income that we had. So the total there, again, the museum services, 72 scientific name verified, and the ID services, which of course are paid, represents about a significant 10 to 20% of the income that we get, especially now, because most of the National Museum does not do the service anymore. So most of the students come over to Los Baños to have their specimens ID. In terms of human resource development, the reps were able to do their postgraduate studies. Four were able to finish their masters within the 6 years, and two were able to complete their PhD, including David Nirol there. And Jennifer Niam came back from her study leave in Australia. Dr. De Leon was able to do her postdoc in UP Diliman. And of course, we had several local international trainings attended by our staff mainly. But also our curators had, of course, had their multitude of different travels and trainings. But the staff from done in different universities, especially with specific taxon groups on their study from the Field Museum, to University of Kansas, the University of Ohio, Kyoto, and of course, again, the details are in our annual reports for all those list of places that our reps and admin staff are able to go to. Of course, within within the museum, we had some in-house training, especially for that helps involve our own studies. So on biosafety, caving, and of course, when we did the forest canopy, we did a single rope technique. Yes po, nakakit po ako ng puno kahit po hindi 20 meters, 10 meters lang. I didn't realize it was so difficult to use those harnesses. But yeah, it was a very interesting training. I also have in-house trainings for photography, website design, bioinformatics, of course, with the together with ACB, we had the collections database management, and of course, with Dr. Dede had biosafety. Apart from all the UP-based workshops that are required to do the admin work. We're also very fortunate to have a lot of collaborations and linkages, several MOAs and MOUs completed across the 6 years, again, both national and international. Of course, there are the museum group associations from ENCOM, the National Council of Museums, Southern Luzon Association of Museums, Society for Preservation of Natural History Collections, and International Council Museum. And of course, the different agencies, government agencies from DNR, DEA, DOD, DOSD, DEPED, NAST, NRCP, and PICARD. Of course, we always have to be, being a museum, we're also had a lot of collaborations with the National Museum, National Commission for Culture and the Arts, and of course, the Museo Pagdilea. As you see there in the picture of the National Museum, I think we were the only non-donor who was able to attend their soft launch of the Natural History Museum. Also had a lot of linkages with universities, the academe, both international and local, from Kansas, Oklahoma, Texas, Washington, of course, USD, UPLU, and Central Mindanao. We have here the different institutions from PhilZoos to Abilon, UCFI. With caving, we had Balinkagin Conservancy from Abini, Misungi from Quezon, the regional cave committees and the natural cave committees, again, being involved with a lot of cave research. The ASEAN Center for Biodiversity, BCSP, NRC, CPBI, PSM, Philippine Eagle, California Group with the study in Sarog, GSIS, and of course, the group of geologists from UP Diliman. Apart from that, we also are involved with the different networks for the herbaria, especially Cahope and LBC. Of course, the Microbial Culture Collection has its own set of networks, so always having these linkages. To sort of help house the increasing number of collections, we had to think about where to put them. So luckily, again, the UP administration was very helpful in kind of leading us towards producing a proposal to help not only renovate our very old buildings, but also to create an annex to help house, because again, the collections are again on separate areas. So we're in four locations at the moment. So this proposal was on the modernization of the museum as a world-class university museum. There's two phases. One is phase one, basically, was the annex. So you can then move on the collections, put together the collections there. And then that will be the place where you could set in the offices while phase two occurs, which is, of course, the renovation of the old building in the quad. So this was carried through a lot of planning with OVCPD, then Vice Chancellor Madlambayan, with the help of Architect Aday, Architect Manuel, and of course from UPLB, there's Mom Kelly Torres. Thank you very much for all your help. Again, they're all still quite interesting proposals, which is basically phase two. We also had a proposal to, actually the provincial government said, oh, ganda ng building niyo, luma na, this should be a heritage site. So there's sort of a proposal to pronounce it as a heritage building, but again, we need to have it renovated before you have it, or else mahirap siyang i-renovate pag naka-heritage siya. So same thing happens with the hortorium, which now requires fencing to improve its security. We also need to improve our electrical and Wi-Fi. We had actually na-estimate na siya, it's just a matter of getting the funding. Same thing with the report collection in the Kahop, we had these proposals done and estimates. Currently, we're following all these different plans for safety, especially for future-proofing from OHSS to fire safety and biosafety. And across 6 years, we were able to add and refurbish 30 exhibits in the museum. So there's a lot happening across these two terms. Get very productive po ang staff and curators of the museum. Of course, everything has to be put out there through social media, and thanks for the internet, we were able to do a lot of linkages because of that multimedia influence. And so we have our webpage. Again, it's not updated again, so if you have a chance to look at the webpage after this presentation, please do so and see the photo shoot po ang staff, so may bago po silang pictures of the website. I think susunod na po ang curators. So again, yes, thank you. Social media accounts, we have Facebook, a Facebook group, and then the Twitter, Instagram, Google Current, and of course, TripAdvisor. So we can get the, so we are kind of acknowledged by TripAdvisor as a tourist destination in Laguna. Of course, our Wikipedia page is very useful. So if you have questions, the Wikipedia page is there. There's two translations now, it's in German and another in Wiki One. So yeah, marami po siyang versions. You have the YouTube channel with a lot of videos from all the seminars and conferences are recorded and put together, aside from all the expeditions put together, including sa Pulilio and sa BATS. We have, of course, our AVP there at our YouTube channel, UPLB MNH. All our social media accounts are at UPLB Museum. So again, if you want to access that, it's at UPLB Museum. Online services are also there in our webpage. Yes, a lot of the what to do and how to do in terms of preparing specimens for identifications, and also different webinars are there. Through the multimedia and social media package, we have our digitization projects. So na put out na yung in line with GBIFM ACB. We also have these the images of herps that were put out together online. We've worked a lot on multimedia together with OPR, of course, OICA, Kisar Yapo, UPLB Horizon, of course, DZRA, Chuadu Henyo. Altogether, we had about so far 8,761 likes on our Facebook page, 1,314 followers on Twitter. So, sana po, tingnan nyo para madagdagan nyo. For our info portal, from our about 249 posters, a total of 90,000 visitors from that. So again, thank you. And again, we have a lot of choices in terms of social media accounts. Please do visit and help increase our statistics. Of course, you can learn a lot as well. Again, for all of us who've gone through this pandemic, The museum was closed ever since lockdown to visitors. It's a drastic drop from 41,000 visitors in 2019 to just roughly 16,000, which was the start of kind of the season for visitors from January to March. Of course, everything closed. We hope to reopen to visitors, but we are open now since after lockdown. We went to GCQ. Our services are open, running into a hybrid schedule in most of that time. So all of those are now online museum services which you can access. Again, if you need to go through the collections, we have biosafety protocols in place, so you can do the and look at the collections. All our seminars are now converted to Zoom webinars, including the symposium held at the 44th anniversary. And the Makiling Ark, which is actually a physical exhibit, was then made into a virtual exhibit. So again, do visit our online material to look at these virtual exhibits and online digital image database. So yan po ang aming mga pictures na. Mamaya po kailangan din natin mag-ganyan. Don't forget to open your video and smile for a photo video. Okay, for the benefit of our the next director, hopefully meron pong ma-declare ang search committee. So sana po meron kayo ni-nominate. So there are a lot of limitations issues as any other institution would have. First and foremost, we are our collections are decentralized. It's all in basically different locations, in four main locations and buildings, and then within the building in four different areas. Tatlong wing. So FBS, we have the herbarium, the forest herbarium. On BSI, we had four collections. Wing A and Tom collection and zoology, wildlife. Wing B, mycology, and then wing C, you have the botanical herbarium. Then of course, you have portorium, which is very much separate on BD Bridge. So again, yeah, also because they're very old collections, the buildings are also quite old, need a lot of repairs, so medyo, it's hard to keep up. Mabilis siya masira, mabilis siya maluma, and of course, the budget doesn't fill easily for all those repairs. We also have a lot of staff turnover, which is difficult. We had to have staff fill in the gap habang wala isa o dalawa dun sa it's a team, so it takes time for them to be filled up. So again, it has a lot of dynamics. We had problems with accessing phone and Wi-Fi connections for Rob, although there was a time na maganda yung Wi-Fi ng MNH. I think that we had three different routers. And then of course now it's just one. So, but again, it's quite good na kaya niyang mag-spread up, but we need to spread it out across the building to access all the different units, especially because we're planning to use a lot of online material in our displays. So hindi siya pag walang Wi-Fi, hindi siya anda. Traffic issues was one of the problems aside from the DepEd and CHED field trip cuts na bumaba yung visitorship because nagre-reklamo sila na traffic pa Laguna, so don't have less time. We had parking issues, although now hindi na parking issue. And then of course you have the COVID-19 lockdown. Smiley was a problem for some time at the Hortorium. Now, wala na siya doon. I don't know if she's going to come back, but again, it was one of the challenges. Of course, now we have a lot to look into in terms, especially with biosafety, future-proofing for disaster risk management, of course, and are trying our best to meet up with the international standards for museums. So again, there's a lot of challenges involved. Again, we're facing it slowly and gradually. So hopefully the next director can address it as well. So what are the pending programs and priorities? Of course, we're lucky to have the phase two funded by UPGAA. Thank you to the staff and of course Senator Gordon for the help of that. So we're able to get about 10 million to do the renovation of the existing building at CFNR Quad. So now because the bidding has been approved, just before lockdown, we need IC papers for it to be implemented and the construction to begin. The next issue would be evacuation. So we have to leave the main building and move out into the different collections and find space. So yeah, sa meeting po namin with Vice Chancellor Detman, tatanong po sa kami pwede ilagay. Well, in the meantime, ilagay po ang museum kung matutuloy po yung renovation this month. Collection facilities, of course, repair and upgrade and storage and getting gradual with our, again, there's a lot of problems in terms of seeding, leaks. Yeah. So mahirap po yan po if you're trying to protect a heritage collection. In terms of the hortatorium, there was a lot of security problems kasi nga bukas siya yung, it's an open area to two different creeks, which is basically Malawin Creek and Pili Creek. So maraming entry points, which you can't put, you can't put the fence over so people go through, including Smiley. So we need to develop that further to a safe environment because it is being used by students for studies. We wanted to review our organizational structure, try to split out certain collections and also try to add in more staff. Also build up a set of duties for curators. So the three units that they use is, can be administered as admin units. But again, that's sort of something in, that needs to be planned very well. We also need to refurbish exhibits and improve our Wi-Fi status. We had it actually estimated by ITC, I think. Parang 1 million yung kailangan namin for a really good Wi-Fi system in the museum. So I think that can follow through once the renovation has finished. Then for that reopening plans, put up a cafe to help improve the income. And hope, and again, with that picture over there of the perspective of the new building, that's phase one actually, to resubmit that to UPGAA for funding. And we're very hopeful na makuha pa din yung ganitong building because it helps, it's quite designed for collection. So it's not a building that was retrofit mo to keep a collection, but it's more built for that purpose. So sana po, it would be an opportunity for this administration. And with that, yes, time flies so quickly when you're having fun. So I'm a bit surprised that 6 years is finished. Para kailan lang kinausap ko ni Sir June at ninominate ko ni Ma'am Nina. So it's basically two terms. 96 new species are added. Thank you to our curators and staff. I said before during the start of my term was it's building towards a globally relevant heritage center and model university museum. So I hope we were able to kind of put our foot up to say that the museum is actually a model university museum. And with the clades, I think we were able to do that. Again, being a BOR created museum of the university, or sort of the National University Museum of Natural History, put that together. So hopefully we did our part over these 6 years, again, together with the curators and staff. Our very sincere thanks for the invaluable support and guidance of UP system, of the two different administrations, again, the outgoing and, of course, the current administration, and, of course, the past directors. Their guidance is very important and very significant. Our MNH curators, again, giving their time, their free time for the museum, and, of course, the and during that, the coordination with the reps, admin staff, even the project staff, intern, volunteers, etc. Maraming salamat po for all your. Again, we couldn't have done all this in 6 years if not for your all the contributions. Of course, our collaborators, our partners, our funding sources, our donors, and even our clients and visitors, and of course, what we call the friends of the museum. Again, maraming salamat mo for all your support through 6 years. Hopefully, you can continue that with the next director, which I'll do as well. I will, as curator, I will continue to contribute to the museum. I'd like to take this time to remember people who, of course, not just the staff who passed away, but also all the people who worked with the museum who have passed through those 6 years. We lost James Anakahano on my first term, and then on my second term, we lost James. So we're very thankful for all their work. They're very dedicated people, they're amazing heroes for biodiversity. Of course, we lost one of our curators, Dr. Gapud, one of our keynote speakers during our anniversary, si Danny Balete, and our keynote speakers, Clades and Dr. Argent. Of course, all the people who've been collaborative with us, other taxonomists, Dr. Tan, Dinantikan, Madamba, Dr. Curiel in Germany, even Sister Jessica who helped us with SLAM, and then of course Dr. Perry Ong is very supportive of all the projects, and of course Sir Paris, who's also helped us with the birds around the museum. So, yes. Maraming salamat po. Again, for details, please go to the website if you want to learn more about them. We also have our different social media accounts. And with that, I'd like to offer you, this is actually made by the staff. Thank you Paul, for this video montage that they put together from all the activities 2015 to 2020. Makikita niyo po ay how I've grown in the museum physically and digitally across those 6 years. Again, thank you to the staff for putting this together. Again, immensely grateful for all for your support through the 6 years. And with that, thank you very much on behalf of the Museum of Natural History, the curators and staff. Maraming salamat po.